I would like first to thank the organizers for inviting me to this workshop, and in particular to asking me to give a brief introductory context about some aspects of brain energy metabolism. And the one I will be focusing on is the work I've been doing for now many years, which is related to neuron-glia metabolic coupling, and in particular, the role that lactate produced by astrocytes, a glial cell type, on different aspects of neuronal functions, plasticity, memory, excitability, and disease. So my lab has been interested over three decades to try to understand mechanisms that underlie the coupling between the electrochemical events that occur at the synapse and metabolic responses. And over the years, my lab and other labs have shown that astrocytes, a type of glial cell, play a key role in this coupling. And this coupling has a number of points of relevance with several questions. One about neuroenergetics, which is probably the main topic of our conversation today, about neuronal plasticity, which I will not say much today, and also on disease. And another point is that this coupling between synaptic activity and metabolic responses, and in fact also vascular responses, is key to produce the signal that are detected with functional brain imaging techniques. So astrocytes are ideally positioned to play such a role. They have processes that surround synapses. Here you have an EM3D reconstruction, you have a presynaptic profile, a postsynaptic profile, and here in blue, these lamellar processes that belong to astrocytes. Actually, they are interesting because they, first of all, they are dynamic. This coverage of the, or ensheathment of the synaptic connections are dynamic. They vary depending on experience or time and condition. And also these lamellae express receptors and reuptake sites for neurotransmitters. So they clearly can be involved in synaptic plasticity and function. And other processes of astrocytes surround capillaries. You have here a capillary negative covered by astrocytic processes. And here at the EM level, this particular astrocytic profile, the end foot, which essentially intraparenchymal capillaries are covered by this astrocytic end feet, which express transporters for a variety of molecules, including, of course, glucose, monocarboxylate, fatty acids, etc. And just to go back to the synaptic contact, keep in mind that in a mouse brain, a single astrocyte can actually interface with over 100,000 synapses. So over the years, we have described mainly two major mechanisms of metabolic coupling, whereby a neuronal signal affects astrocytic metabolism. The first one is glycogenolysis. Glycogen is present only in astrocytes or almost exclusively in astrocytes. And neuromodulators such as noradrenaline, a vasoactive intestinal peptide or adenosine, or by the way, also high potassium, which is produced by neuronal activity, can promote glycogenolysis. And another mechanism is actually mediated by glutamate released at synapses, glutamate uptake, and activation of a cascade of intracellular cascades that eventually leads to the uptake of glucose and the stimulation of glycolysis. And both glycogenolysis and glycolysis in astrocytes, under normal conditions, result in the release of lactate. And by the way, this is a process well known, is called aerobic glycolysis or Warburg effect, which is the production of lactate in the presence of oxygen. And lactate is a fully adequate substrate because in the presence of oxygen, it can be transformed to pyruvate and then enter the Krebs cycle. And these articles have reviewed this quite extensively. Now, a bit more in detail about this dialogue mediated by lactate. So as mentioned earlier, here you have the astrocyte, the neuron, And then these modulators and potassium can promote glycogenolysis, and then glutamate and others that have been shown later, for example, by the group of Felipe Barros, and ammonium, potassium can also promote glucose uptake through the glucose transporter, GLUT1, and result in lactate production, which can then be released through two main transporters, MCT1 and MCT4. MCT4 clearly purely astrocytic. And then this lactate on neurons can either be taken up, and this is what we have been mostly studying, through MCT2 transporters, and then this lactate converting to pyruvate, then as a dual function, which we revealed the second one, signaling only about during the last decade. But the first one is purely neuroenergetic. Pyruvate can enter the Krebs cycle and produce ATP. But also through LDH1, lactate dehydrogenase 1, contrasting with lactate dehydrogenase 5 in astrocytes, NADH is produced when lactate is transformed to pyruvate. And we have shown, and others have shown, that NADH can modulate the activity of NMDA receptors and eventually is responsible for the signaling role of lactate in modulating the expression of a number of genes that are involved in plasticity, such as ARK, EGR1, BDNF, and a few others, also in neuroprotective genes, making therefore lactate not only a neuroenergetic substrate, but also a signaling molecule for plasticity and excitability. And so this gives an overview of this dialogue. There are also some receptors for lactate, whose function is not completely understood. There is an HCAR1 orphan GPCR receptor that is negatively coupled to adenylate cyclase. There may be other receptors. In general, lactate seems to have an inhibitory effect on excitability. So in summary, the point I'd like to make in this introductory remark is that when considering brain metabolism, one should consider not only neurons, but also glial cells, and in particular astrocytes, and the metabolic mechanisms that take place in astrocytes under the direction of neuronal signals, such as modulators, but also glutamate in particular. And that another point I like to make, which is relevant for some form of epilepsy, is GLUT1. Glucose transporter 1 is present only in astrocytes and endothelial cells, capillary endothelial cells. In neurons, there is GLUT3. And interestingly enough, a genetic form where there is a different mutations of the glucose transporter 1 leads to a form of epilepsy, which is known as de Vivo disease or GLUT1 deficiency syndrome. And this is certainly an area of great direct access to better understand epilepsy and astrocytic metabolism. And this is, by the way, something that we are focusing on at the present moment. So thank you very much. I hope this very brief introduction has provided you with some sensitized you to the importance of astrocytes and lactate in brain function and also in excitability. Thank you very much for your attention.